Brain of Britain, the nationwide general knowledge contest, chaired by Russell Davis.
Ah, that lovely sound again. Thank you. Hello and a warm welcome to a brand new series of Brain of Britain. In this information age when you can find the answer to everything with a tap of your phone or a quick word with Alexa, we're here to celebrate the virtues of carrying knowledge in your head. 48 brave people from all over the UK will put their general knowledge up for scrutiny in our knockout tournament over the next 4 months. The 12 outright heat winners and the four top-scoring runners-up will go through to the next stage. And eventually, in July, we'll find out who our 2020 Brain of Britain turns out to be. Our first four contenders this year are with me on the stage here at the Radio Theatre in London. Let's meet them.
Hello, my name is John Adedoyin, and I'm a management consultant from London.
Hello, I'm Hugh Brady. I'm a scientist from London.
Hello, I'm Andrew Codling, a recovering business analyst from Egham in Surrey.
Hello, I'm Ellie Mackin. I'm a writer and translator from Beeston in Nottinghamshire.
Thank you all. There aren't many rules to remember in Brain of Britain. I'll keep asking you questions until you get one wrong or can't answer, in which case I'll open it up to the others, and then we'll move on to the next person's turn. You have 10 seconds to think about each answer, should you need them, and the moment you hear this, your time has run out, and I can't accept your answer, I'm afraid. Good luck, everyone. We always go around in alphabetical order of surname, so it's John Adedoyin who gets the very first question of the 2020 series. What female name was given to the hurricane which devastated the city of New Orleans in 2005, from which the restoration work and political fallout continue to this day?
Hurricane Katrina.
Yes. In December 2019, the cricketer Ben Stokes was named BBC Sports Personality of the Year. Which former winner of the title was the runner-up?
Sorry, don't know.
Yes, Hugh Brady.
Lewis Hamilton.
Lewis Hamilton is right, yes, and it's your question. The character of Mr. Dick in Dickens's David Copperfield has been described as one of the earliest portrayals in literature of a recognisable mental illness. Mr. Dick hears the voice of King Charles I in his head, uttering phrases used in the period before his execution. Which British actor played Mr. Dick in Armando Iannucci's film The Personal History of David Copperfield?
Hugh Laurie?
Yes, it was. Tower Bridge in London is an example of what type of bridge that takes its name from a French word meaning a seesaw?
Cantilever?
No. Ellie Mackin?
Bastille?
No. Any more tries? No lights? No. That was very close, but the word is bascule. C-U-L-E. Andrew Codling, which keyboard symbol previously of use mainly to computer programmers was first used on Twitter on August the 23rd, 2007 by technology developer Chris Messina?
Hashtag.
That's the right answer. According to an essay by T.S. Eliot, immature poets imitate, mature poets do what?
Innovate?
No. Anybody recall this? No. No, the answer was mature poets steal. No, Ellie Mackin, the Three Flavours Cornetto trilogy is a series of three films starring Simon Pegg and Nick Frost and directed by Edgar Wright. Which film follows 2004's Shaun of the Dead and 2007's Hot Fuzz to complete the trilogy? Nope. Time's up. Hugh Brady.
End of the World?
No, I can't give you that, I'm afraid. No. Andrew Codling.
The World's End.
The World's End. Yes, we have to have the right formula for that title. And we've reached the end of the first round of the contest. These are the scores. Ellie Mackin has yet to score. John Adedoyin has won. Hugh Brady and Andrew Codling, two apiece. Directly onward to John Adedoyin again. The two houses in the suburbs of Liverpool where John Lennon and Paul McCartney grew up, Mendip's and 24th Lynn Road, respectively, are now both owned by which organisation?
National Trust.
Yes, you're right. In Greek myth, what was the name of the enchantress who lived on the island of Aeaea, who turned half of Odysseus's crew into swine after drugging them at a banquet?
Medea.
Not Medea, no. Andrew Codling knows.
Circe.
Circe is right. She turned them back into men after she failed to similarly transform Odysseus himself because he was protected by a magic antidote. Hugh Brady now, your question. Which bird, with a name derived from the Gaelic for a horse of the wood, is the largest member of the grouse family?
Capercaillie.
Yes. In geology, eustace is the name given to worldwide changes that occur in the level of what?
Sea level.
The sea, seawater is the right answer. Yes, well done. In chemistry, what does the abbreviation REEE stand for?
Reduction?
Nope, afraid not. And no lights have appeared so far. Nope, nobody knows. The answer is rare earth elements. Andrew Codling, we come round to you again. A statue in Lushan County, Henan Province, China, is the tallest depiction in the world of which figure?
The Buddha.
The Buddha, indeed. In Beatrix Potter's The Tale of Samuel Whiskers, which character is seized by two rats and wrapped up in a roly-poly dumpling pudding?
Tom Kitten.
You remembered that. Well done, yes. You're right. Name two South American countries through which the equator passes.
Ecuador and Colombia.
Those will do fine. Yes, the other one is so big it could hardly miss Brazil. Yes, but you're right. Linking North and South China over a distance of some 1,100 miles, the world's longest man-made waterway, the Grand Canal, connects Beijing to which city, the capital of Zhejiang?
Shan?
No. John Adedoyin?
Guangzhou.
Yes, Hangzhou, yes, yes. H-A-N-G-Z-H-O-U. Ellie Mackin, the painter Johannes Vermeer was born in and made many paintings of which Dutch town?
Delft.
Yes. How many players are there in a standard netball team?
Five.
No. Yes, Andrew Codling.
Six.
Nope. Any more offers? It's only a number, John Adedoyin.
Seven.
Seven is right. Yes, no. And that completes the second round with the scores like this. Ellie Mackin has now opened the score with one. John Adedoyin and Hugh Brady, four each. Andrew Codling now six. Okay, a bit of a change for you this time round, John Adedoyin. Some music for you, and it's a melody by Wagner, as arranged by another well-known composer. You have to name the man who made the arrangement.
Debussy?
No. Hugh Brady?
Rachmaninoff?
No. Andrew Codling?
Mahler?
No. Ellie, going to have a go?
Prokofiev?
No. It was Franz Liszt. We heard his arrangement of the Liebestod from Tristan and Isolde, played by Vladimir Horowitz. Wagner married Liszt's daughter, Cosima, in 1870. Hugh Brady now. In nuclear physics, which two-word phrase means the smallest amount of fissile material needed for a sustained nuclear chain reaction?
Critical mass?
Critical mass is right, yes. Throughout her lifetime, and indeed after, the Russian dancer Anna Pavlova was famed for her highly acclaimed solo dance, The Dying Swan. It was set to music by Saint-Saëns, but which Russian-born dancer choreographed the piece?
Nijinsky?
No. John Adedoyin?
Dialyev?
Nope.
No.
No more, no. It was Mikhail Fokin, if you like, yes. And Andrew Codling, now it's your turn. By what Latin name is the cartographer born Gerard de Cremer better known?
Mercator.
Yes, Gerardus Mercator. Which famous square did Napoleon call the most beautiful drawing room in Europe?
The Place de la Concorde?
No. No, no lights. Yes, Ellie Mackin.
The Hall of Mirrors at Versailles?
No. It's not going to come, is it? No, it was the Piazza San Marco, St. Mark's Square in Venice. Ellie Mackin now. At the beginning of Victor Hugo's novel Les Misérables, Jean Valjean has been released from jail after having served a 19-year sentence for what offence?
Theft?
No, it's specific, this... Yes, Hugh Brady.
Stealing bread?
Yes, stealing a loaf of bread. Bread is the operative word in that answer. Here are the scores again. Ellie Mackin, 1. John Adedoyin, 4. Hugh Brady, 6. Andrew Codling, 7. And with that, we've come to the point in the programme where we let our brains sit back and have a breather. They'll still be answering questions, but collaboratively this time, not competitively, and these won't make any difference to the scores. I have a pair of questions here drawn from the very many excellent suggestions you've sent us in the past year or so. Let me say now, at the beginning of the series, that I'm very sorry we don't have room to fit in all of your ideas. Some people really do put a lot of effort into thinking up questions, and many of you say very nice things about how much you enjoy the programme too. Unfortunately, we can only use one person's ideas per show, and sometimes even flattery can't prevent some very good ones being left out. For the opening contest of the 2020 season, we've chosen questions from listener Philip Aston, who emailed them to brainofbritain@bbc.co.uk. If our brains can't deal adequately with Philip's questions, he'll be deemed to have beaten the brains, and we'll be sending him a book voucher prize. Heads together then, the four of you. Philip asks, first of all, a rare health condition which can cause a sensation of feeling larger or smaller than you really are, distorted perception of time and distance, and objects seeming closer or further away than they really are, is sometimes abbreviated to AWS. What does AWS stand for?
I don't know.
Something Alice in Wonderland syndrome would be my guess.
Oh, that sounds familiar, yes.
We'll go with it. Yeah. Okay. Right. Alice in Wonderland syndrome.
Exactly right. Well done, yes. It is also known as Todd's syndrome, after the psychiatrist John Todd, who described it in the 1950s, but you gave the much more picturesque answer. Now, question two then. This might be a bit more tricky. Lewis Carroll's books, Alice in Wonderland, and its sequel, Through the Looking Glass and What Alice Found There, were banned in China in 1931. For what reason?
1931. But I know that they banned books there now, or I think they banned books there now with talking animals in. Mm-hmm. I think.
Because it wasn't real.
Okay.
It was a fantasy.
Does that sound fair?
Yeah.
Talking animals.
Because they don't allow books with talking animals in?
Yes, you're actually right. Because... I didn't think you'd get that, but yes, it's precisely because they've featured talking animals. The official censor in Hunan province deemed it dangerous that young children should be exposed to stories portraying animals as having the same intelligence as human beings. So, I'm sorry, Philip Aston, the brains did manage to dispatch both of your questions in the manner required, so I'm afraid we can't send you a prize on this occasion. But from all of us here at the Radio Theatre, you do win this dangerously animalistic round of applause. We do love receiving your question ideas, and I promise you we give very careful consideration to them all, even if we don't always have time to acknowledge them in person. You can send ideas to us by email at brainofbritain@bbc.co.uk or on paper to Brain of Britain, Dock House, Media City, UK, Salford M50 2LH. That's the end of the collaboration then. It's back to the contest proper, and back to you, John Adedoyin, for the next round. In 2019, the Guardian newspaper published its list of the top 100 best books of the 21st century so far. Which Booker Prize-winning British historical novel that opens with the words, "So now get up," was placed at number one?
Wolf Hall?
By Henry de Mantel. Yes, you're quite right. In February 2019, a parliamentary aide of Theresa May won a bet after getting the then Prime Minister to use a certain word whilst in the House of Commons. What was this word?
Omnishambles?
No. Well-remembered word, but it wasn't that one. Nobody remembers. It flashed by without your notice, evidently. No? Nope, the answer was simples, inspired by the adverts featuring a CGI meerkat, if you've seen that. In response to a question from the Scottish National Party's Ian Blackford, May said he should vote for a deal. Simples. And May's aide apparently won tea at the Ritz. Hugh Brady. There's music with your next question, and the piece you're about to hear is an instrumental track from a debut album released in 1974 by an American group. I'd just like you to tell me which group this is.
The Doobie Brothers?
No. Yes, John Adedoyin.
Machine Gun Commodores.
Exactly right. That's the title, Machine Gun, and it was the Commodores. Well done. Andrew Codling, much was made last year of the general election being held in December for the first time in almost a century. In fact, three December elections were held in the first quarter of the 20th century. Can you give me any one of those years?
1912?
No. Hugh Brady?
1918?
Yes, that was the middle one. The three of them were 1910, 1918, and 1923. Ellie Mackin, your question. Which raptor, with a wingspan of up to 10.5 feet, is the national bird of several countries in South America and is also incorporated into the flags of Ecuador and Bolivia?
Condor.
The Andean condor, yes, Vultur gryphus, who collectively are Perry Edwards, Leanne Pinnock, Jade Thirlwall, and Jesse Nelson?
I don't know.
Right. And Andrew Codling does know.
Little Mix.
They are Little Mix. They won 2011's X Factor and went on to have hits with songs such as Black Magic and Shout Out to My Ex. End of a round. Ellie Mackin now 2, John Adedoyin 6, Hugh Brady 7, Andrew Codling 8. A good burst by anyone could win this, John Adedoyin. Let's see if it'll be you. Arguably, the three best-known books of Robert Louis Stevenson, Treasure Island, Kidnapped, and The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, were all published within the same decade. Which decade?
1880s.
Correct answer, yes. In the context of a musical gathering, what's the usual spelling of the word Cayley?
Oh, C-E-I-L-D-H.
No. Hugh Brady?
C-E-I-L-I in Irish or C-E-I-L-I-D-H in Scottish?
That's right. C-E-I-L-I-D-H. The I was missing. I think you meant to put it in, John, but it wasn't there. It's from the Scots Gaelic, this version anyway. Hugh Brady's question. In the American version of the Harry Potter stories, Dumbledore's favourite sweets are lemon drops. Not so in the original British stories. What was his favourite there?
Licorice all sorts.
No. That's fair enough, but no. Ellie Mackin?
Sherbet lemons.
Sherbet lemons, yes. Not the same thing at all. And it does matter, because sherbet lemon is the password into Dumbledore's office. Yes, Andrew Codling, your music question features an extract from a song by the Eurythmics. Your question comes when we've heard it.
Julia,
when the leaves turn from green to brown and autumn shades gone tumbling down, Julia,
to leave a carpet on the ground where we have lain.
Now, the song you just heard was part of the soundtrack to a film that starred John Hurt. Which film?
1984.
Yes, the song was called Julia. The title of Orwell's novel has always been 1984, written out as words, whereas the film's title had it as a numeral, to the irritation of some critics. The former England footballer Steve Hodge donated a blue football shirt to the National Football Museum, which had been worn during an infamous sporting event in 1986. Who was its original owner?
Maradona?
Yes, Diego Maradona. And it was the 1986 World Cup, Argentina, the match notorious for the Hand of God incident, which, of course, the accursed VAR would have spotted. Or not, as the case may be. And by what name, later adopted as a play title by Joe Orton, was the device more properly called a mutoscope, commonly known in the UK?
What the Butler Saw.
It was the What the Butler Saw machine. Which town, the ancient capital of Cornwall, gave its name to a port city of northern Tasmania?
Hobart?
No. John Adedoyin?
Penzance?
No. Hugh Brady?
Launceston.
Launceston. That is the right answer, yes. And Ellie Mackin's question comes around now. In 2020, which British instrumentalist's recording of Elgar's Cello Concerto became the first classical album for 30 years to reach the British Top 10 Albums chart?
I'm afraid I don't know.
Okay. Who does? Hugh Brady does.
Canon Mason.
Shekel Canemason, yes, rubbing shoulders with Ed Sheeran and Stormzy. It was the first classical recording to appear in the top 10 bestsellers since Nigel Kennedy's Four Seasons disc in 1989. Another end of round, here are the scores. Ellie Mackin, 3, John Adedoyin, 7, Hugh Brady, 10, Andrew Codling, 11. Those scores are close at the top, and this, folks, has to be the final round of the contest. So, John Adedoyin, back to you. What is the title of the poem by Henry Reed, satirizing the four quartets of T.S. Eliot, whose first line runs, "As we get older, we do not get any younger"?
Pass.
Okay. Yes, Andrew Codling.
Is it Your Old Father Tom?
No. Nobody remembers this? No. It was called Charred Whitlow, doubtless a play on Burnt Norton, one of the four quartets. It appears in Henry Reed's volume called A Map of Verona. Hugh Brady, Radhika Jones, Tina Brown, and Graydon Carter have all held the position of editor-in-chief of which magazine that covers fashion, politics, and popular culture?
Vanity Fair.
Yes, you're right. Of the eight kings of England named Henry, who had the longest reign?
Third.
Yes, Henry III, King of England from 1216 to 1272, a very long time for that period. According to American myth, who dug out the Grand Canyon by dragging his axe behind him?
Prester John? No.
No. Yes, Andrew Codling.
Paul Bunyan.
Is the right answer, yes. And it's your question. In the 1980s, which fashion designer was responsible for the once ubiquitous Frankie Says Relax T-shirt?
Jeff Wayne?
No. Yes, John Adedoyin, remember.
Vivienne Westwood?
No. Any more offers? No, there are not. It was Catherine Hamnett. She who devised it. Ellie Mackin, here's a piece of music for you, and it's a song which in 2019 broke the record for the longest stay at number one in the UK by any solo female singer ever. Your question comes after we've heard it.
Say, dance for me, dance for me, dance for me, oh, oh. I never seen anybody do the things you do before. They say, move for me, move for me, move for me.
Well, that singer goes by the pseudonym Tones and I. I'd simply like to know what nationality Tones and I is.
Australian?
Yes, Australian. Her name is Toni Watson, and that song has been number one in more than 30 countries around the world. In Stella Gibbons's classic comic novel Cold Comfort Farm, one of the characters, Aunt Ada Doom, repeatedly refers to having seen something nasty in the what?
Woodshed.
Woodshed. Naturally, we never discover what it was. He had a fire in his eye, a fever in his blood, a maggot in his brain, a hectic flutter in his speech, which mark out the philosophic fanatic. That was William Hazlitt in his Table Talk, describing which English poet who died in 1822?
Keats.
Not Keats, no. Hugh Brady?
Byron.
Not Byron either, I'm afraid. Andrew Codling?
Shelley.
It was Percy Bysshe Shelley, yes indeed. Well done. Which brings us to the end of this first heat of Brain of Britain 2020, and the final scores are as follows. Ellie Mackin, 5. John Adedoyin, 7. Hugh Brady, 12. Andrew Codling, 13. And that means Andrew Codling will definitely be back for the semi-finals later in the year. Very well done indeed, and we look forward to seeing you then. But as I mentioned, we also invite the four highest scoring runners-up of the series back for the semi-finals, so there may well be hope for Hugh Brady as well, with a score of 12. Of course, it's far too early in the season to be sure, but hope there is. Next week, we'll meet our next four competitors, starting their bids to become Brain of Britain 2020. I hope you'll join us. Thanks for listening today, and goodbye.